नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय सो वेरी हैप्पी टू बी हियर दिस पर्टिकुलर हॉल इज लाइक ए किड्स प्लेग्राउंड फॉर अस our first baby steps in bhakti were taken here so remembering many satsang programs with maharaj and especially 31st december 1989 the new year's ringing in the new year program and I was working at that time and I was not feeling a bit well so halfway in the program I just walked out and I saw Krishnachandra Prabhu following me as I was putting on my shoes he said you're leaving early I said, yeah, I'm feeling a bit feverish. So he said, okay, we will miss you. And I was, all the while I walked to Grand Road Station, I was thinking, he's going to miss me? I thought he hardly knows me. In fact, anybody in the congregation could not say that for sure, yeah, we know this boy, he comes regularly. So, That was the love and affection which nurtured us and remember Maharaj giving an example of how Krishna wrestles with his friends and how it is taken to be play and he said right now if Prabhuji wrestles with Priyavrat and he was carrying Priyavrat with him and if he defeats him would we be all celebrating or if Priyavrat does something and Prabhuji falls on the ground will that be a cause for celebration so that memory also is there so Bali Maharaj and Shukracharya celebrated pastime of Krishna actually cheating. In Vrindavan we see Krishna stealing, here we see Krishna cheating and it is still glorified. Many years ago I had read the Upadesh of Shukracharya and I thought how come he is giving this kind of an instruction that don't give him don't this is Vishnu don't do this this Vaman Dwadashi somehow I felt inspired to read the pastime from the Bhagavatam and also especially follow His Holiness Srila Radha Govind Maharaj's classes, very excellent narrations, one he gave in Mira Road and one in Noida. Both files are available in the ISKCON Desiree file area. So therefore, when I was instructed to speak on any particular theme, I called it defiance. How a guru how a disciple dare disobey his guru. Normally we see that adau guru padashraya, the first thing in devotion service is to take shelter of a spiritual master. And Parikshit Maharaj, he also asked this important question. I saw Chaitanya Prabhu's notes about yesterday, how Govind Prabhu spoke on throughout the Bhagavatam, Parikshit Maharaj kept on asking questions. And it was the questions which kept the conversation alive. Some of the prominent things which I remember, one is in the 10th canto where Shukadeva Goswami just says, "And my dear king, Aghasur was killed by Krishna by entering into his body. When Krishna saw that all his friends also had entered Aghasura's body, then Krishna entered, expanded himself, and then Aghasura's life air burst out. And then they all came out, they glorified Krishna. And the Brajavasis started discussing this after 1 year. Just a small mention that after 1 year, the Vrindavan residents were discussing it. And then Krishna again started, and Parikshit Maharaj says, "Wait a minute, Guru Maharaj, why there was a gap of 1 year? Normally what was happening in the morning, in the evening all the Brajavasi homes would be discussing that." He says, "Oh, thank you for keeping this conversation alive." That was because Brahma came and stole all the coward boys. So those boys who came back home were actually Krishna. The calves who came back home were actually Krishna. And for 1 year this thing continued. And therefore there was a gap of 1 year. While recounting various manus, a manu is like a IAS officer, an appointed collector or an administrator. And Shukadeva Goswami says, during one manu's, manvantar means his reign, the time during which he is ruling, Lord Hari came and saved the king of elephants while he was fighting against a crocodile. And immediately Parikshit Maharaj says, "What was that? I never heard that pastime." So then he tells the whole Gajendra Moksha story. So similarly, it is in the 13th chapter of 8th canto that for the first time this topic comes up, that Bali gave in charity and he lost all the three worlds. And Lord Vishnu was very pleased with him and then gave everything back. So could you please tell me more about this? So from the 13th chapter, then the actual conversation happens in the 15th chapter of the 8th canto, which begins, the first verse of 15th chapter begins with this question. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is a proprietor of everything. Then why should he beg? If the Lord already owns everything, what's the purpose of begging? Etat veditum icchamo महत कौतूहलम ही नह. गुरु महाराज, आई वॉन्ट टू आस्क यू दिस मेन क्वेश्चन. इफ द लॉर्ड इज सपोज टू बी द ओनर ऑफ एवरीथिंग, देन वाई शुड ही बी बेगिंग? सो देन द बैक स्टोरी इज गिवन. ड्यूरिंग द देवासुर संग्राम, ड्यूरिंग द बैटल बिटवीन द डेमिगॉड्स एंड डीमंस, Bali Maharaj was killed by Indra. He actually lost his life. Many other demons also lost their lives. And Shukracharya, with his Sanjeevani Vidya, Sanjeevani means which you can make a dead person alive. Shukracharya brought Bali Maharaj back to life. Then he became his disciple, a surrendered disciple. And then Shukracharya performed a ritualistic sacrifice called Vishwajita. It is described in Srimad Bhagavatam that when the Vishwajita sacrifice was over, Bali Maharaj got a celestial looking armor. He was dazzling, he was effulgent like the sun. He got weaponry, he got all his soldiers back. And funnily, Shukdev Goswami starts describing a slight glimpse of the heavenly planets. How everything is nice, there is no sweat, there is no fatigue. There are women who are so fragrant, their bodies are so fragrant, that when they walk, the whole road becomes fragrant. And it is almost enticing that somebody would think that, hey, maybe we should go there. And then he gives a condition that anyone who is lusty, greedy, self-conceited, proud, arrogant, foolish, stupid, he has no entry there. That's how Swarga is kind of constituted. All my life, practically reading Puranas or whatever, right from childhood, it was always, what is the goal of life? To go to Swarga. Anyone dead, I used to read in Loksatta, Maharashtra Times, Swargavasi. It's not, we kind of assume that he died and he went to Swarga. Now there are interesting things about Swarga Lok. There was one merchant and he went to Swarga Lok, and the very first person he met, he started bragging about how many wells he had dug, how many medicines he has donated, clothes he had donated, food he has donated. And after he spoke the whole list about what he had done, they said, your time's up. He said, what do you mean? He said, here you just came and started bragging. Now there is no punya left. So be careful. Don't go and start, you know, telling how smart you are. Swarga, is it like IIT, where everybody is a genius, right? No? No, I suspect it is something like AIMS or IIT, where you look at somebody and say that, don't be so smart, I am also smart. We have both made it. We've all made it. But within them, there is somebody who is All India Rank 2 and All India Rank 3. So then, say, oh, he's second, I am third. I am at two notches little less intelligent than him. He may think you are a little bit more stupid than me. It could be any way. But Radha Govind Maharaj, he gave some information about Swarga. Everybody who comes there is garlanded with a nice garland. And that garland never withers. The flowers never wither. They never go dry. And after hundreds and thousands of years of enjoyment, one day you notice one flower becoming dry. And you say, strange. What happened? After another hundreds and thousands of years, one more flower becomes dry. You may say, all right, there are at least 5 dozen flowers here. 2 don't make big difference. Finally, there is only one flower which is fresh left.
and you know something's going to happen today or tomorrow, today or tomorrow. And suddenly you are whisked away into some area, that flower becomes dry, and you come down. Swarga is called Amara. The people are, demigods are called Amar, the Swarga is called Amara Lok. No one dies in the heavenly planets. True? It is something like a hospital which says no patient dies in our hospital. That's very good. But what they do is, anybody about to die, they just put him in some other ward and he dies from that ward, which is outside the hospital premises. So the hospital record is immaculate. No one dies here. And when rain falls in our material part, the Upanishad describes all these souls are coming down. Those who have finished their sojourn in the heavenly planets. And like the Bhagavad Gita, which answers so many difficult queries with just one or two lines. So Krishna says, Kshine punye martya lokam vishanti. Arjuna, it is as simple as that. Punya is your rocket fuel, so that your rocket goes up. Kshine punye, when the fuel is over, you come back. Now, although I just read the list of how arrogant, stupid, foolish, lusty, angry people cannot get any entry in the Swargaloka planets, but Bali Maharaj's demons are certainly not of that variety. They are not sadhus. They are not ashram inmates. So how did they attack? How did they come there? So this also is a warning for those who feel that once you go into Swarga, it is all enjoyment. And that's why when people gather together, they hear Mahabharata, Ramayana, Bhagavatam, whatever, and then they see that, hey, even the Swargaloka is attacked. Even Swargaloka life is not eternal. That's meant to push you towards asking, so where is life eternal? Where is it found? So now let us understand what happened at that particular time. Bali Maharaj, being very powerful, and especially the principles of becoming powerful are the same, whether it is Satya Yuga, Treta Yuga, Dwapar, Kali, whatever. Anybody who is favored by a Brahmana or favored by sages, they prosper. Anyone who has insulted Brahmanas or is committed offense against them, they lose their power. So Shukracharya is the spiritual master of the Asuras, and he's very powerful. In fact, Krishna glorifies him in Bhagavad Gita. Ushna Kavi, among poets, among the learned poets, I am Ushna. Ushna is Shukracharya. So Shukracharya understood that for some reason Indra has committed an offense. And offense means your Sattva Guna comes down. When Sattva goes down, Rajo has to come up. That's the principle. It is December, book distribution month. Many times I could experience this. We would leave the temple at around 4:45 or 5 o'clock and would go to Dadar station or CST station. And at 5:15 in the morning, we are saying Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavad Gita, please take, Hindi, Marathi, English, Gujarati, Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, Sabhi Bharati Bhasha mein uplabh. And it was not dawn yet. The first rays of the sun have not touched. Many times the commuters arriving from through trains, somebody coming from Solapur, somebody coming from South India, they would be all sleepy-eyed, they would look at us. Early morning, these people are shouting Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavad Gita. And then, because it was so much of, it is Brahma Muhurta still, people are having Mangalarti, devotees are chanting. Around 7 o'clock, I could see the first initial rays of Rajoguna touching. And suddenly you have people, chai, 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 coffee, 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 and this, that. And then 7:45, 8 o'clock, 8:30, 9 o'clock. You could actually feel the mode of passion taking over. It was like palpable, it was like you could touch it. Once His Holiness Sachinandan Maharaj said, there are some places in Germany, in Austria, he said, in the butcher's market or in the main town square where people drink and eat meat, he said, the tamoguna is so thick, you can cut it with a knife and take a slice. It is that thick. And in that place, they chant or they distribute books. So, Tribhir Gunamair Bhaver Ebi Sarvam Idam Jagat. Krishna explains, everything is a play of the three modes. You are in Sattvagun, there is a desire for knowledge. You are in Rajogun, you are in a competitive mode. You are in Tamogun, nothing feels interesting. You are in a self-destructive mode or outwardly destructive mode. So, this is how the Bhagavatam brings out this conflict. As Bali Maharaj stands at the outskirts of this Swargaloka, the demigods are fearful. They ask Brihaspati, what do we do? And he said, apart from Vishnu, I don't think anybody can help you. Then he said, so Indra is asking his people, should we put up a fight even? And they say, we don't think so. Just imagine, you were rulers yesterday and you are like Syrian refugees today. You just have the shirts on your back. In fact, some of them didn't even have that. So Brihaspati tells them, just take any form you can. They could change their forms and just vanish. So Bali Maharaj and his commanders, they blow their conch shells and they're like, say, charge, go inside. They go enter that planet, all the mansions are vacant. Indra's asana is vacant. There is nobody there to fight even. And they said, are they hiding somewhere or what exactly is this? So they realize all these hosts of demigods have just left. And they come to their mother, Aditi. It took me some time to understand this, I should confess. But actually the demigods and demons, same father. You realize that? Same father, Kashyapa Muni. One wife, Diti, her progeny is called Daityas, the Asuras. Another wife, Aditi, her progeny is Adityas, the demigods. And Prabhupada frequently made us understand, Dvabhuta Sarge Lokesmin Daiva Asura Evacha. Right from the beginning of Sarge, right from the beginning of creation, this material world has mainly two mindsets, two ways of thinking. Daiva is defined, Asura is not. Daiva is defined as Vishnu Bhakta Smrto Daiva. Anyone feeling some affinity for Vishnu, thinking that I should become a devotee of Vishnu, let us do some bhakti, something, little bit, then you are Daiva category. And what is Asura then? Asurastad Viparyaya. Anyone having nothing to do with Vishnu simply becomes an Asura. So these are two thought processes, these are two ways of thinking. Both work very hard, both are enterprising, Both do pious activities, relatively speaking. Both have scholars, both have gurus. So, what's exactly the difference? That's why it is difficult. I see myself behaving like a demigod sometimes, and I see myself being like a demon sometimes. So they are all there within. So, Aditi, what can she do? Womanly heart. She feels for her sons. And at that time, it is described how Kashyapa Muni came back from his dhyan. These Rishi Munis, the only thing they do is dhyan. He has a household, he has wives, he has kids, but they are all doing their own business. So he comes back, one look at his wife's face and he understands something has gone wrong. So he says, is everything all right? Did you take care of guests who came? Did you behave properly? So he asks a few questions. Are your sons all right? He doesn't say our sons. He says, are your sons okay? And she says, my sons have been destroyed. I also found this in Bhagavatam that what are the occasions in which a person says, I'm gone, I'm destroyed? Mostly it is if your business venture is lost, if your career is lost. Now after you are dead, you can't say I am dead because you won't have any consciousness. But Bhagavatam says there is a bahir pran. There is a pran which lives in your wallet. So when money is lost, a person immediately says, I'm gone, I'm lost. So when the demigods have lost their wealth, even their mother starts saying that, my children are destroyed. Please do something to help them. Kashyapa Muni, for two verses, he becomes a bit philosophical. He says, what is this world? Everything is made of Trigunmayi, three modes of material nature. Look at the illusion. These are my sons and they are having problems. But anyway, Aditi Devi, you are a chaste lady, you are a pure soul. At the beginning of creation, there was a ritual, there was a proper puja, which Brahma taught, Lord Brahma. It is called Payovrata. I will teach you. One big difference between the way demigods and demons behave. Demigods have material desires. Demons have material desires. But demigods, for the solution of any problem, they go to Vishnu. They obey Vishnu's dictate. They take instructions. While demons are choosy, if it suits them, they follow. If it doesn't, they may do something on their own. A little something going wrong, and the demoniac mentality is to curse. The demigods are quick to accept faults. The demoniac mentality is to always find faults in others. So he says, will you do that? She agrees. So it's a 12-day ritual, Payovrat. It's a long thing. I won't be going into so much of detail, but you have to make rice kheer, and you have to feed brahmanas, you have to feed outcasts, you have to feed all members of society, have a cheerful attitude. So she does everything, and in the month of Bhadrapad, this Dwadashi, famous Vaman Dwadashi, the Lord appears before her in a his usual four-armed form, and she's happy, exceedingly happy. She makes beautiful prayers to the Lord, and he says that, I will be appearing as your son, and I cannot defeat the demons right now, because what you want, Lord Vamandev, Lord Vishnu tells her, you would like to see the wives of the demons lamenting on the dead bodies of their husbands, is it not? So Radha Govind Maharaj also pointed out that many times when Krishna looks into our heart and brings out all the things out, we may say, oh, this was the desire I had. Because nothing can be hidden away from Krishna. So Krishna doesn't say, Vishnu doesn't say that this is what I will do, okay, I'll kill them. He said, no. Your desires will be fulfilled to the extent you deserve and to the extent you have faith. So Prabhupada explains in that purport that just like a normal husband and wife come together and they have progeny, he says that's not the way Aditi and Kashyap Muni, they bring forth Lord Vamandev. Lord Vamandev, in fact, described as is never born. It's like the simplest example, you know, the sun. The sun is simply there as it is. It is we who change our position. We say the sun has set or the sun has risen. Otherwise, the sun is always there. So on that day, Lord Vamandev came. So many personalities came. They gave him gifts. Somebody gave him a belt. Somebody gave him a dress made of deer skin. Somebody gave him a kamandalu, a pot. Somebody gave him a rod. Somebody gave him a Brahmin thread. And in this way, immediately after appearing, he performed a yajna. And after performing that yajna, this is not far from where we went, our Amarkantak Yatra, on the banks of the Narmada. May not be this Narmada, but at least Bhrigu Kachcha, that's the place mentioned. And as soon as this yajna was over, they started, Lord Vamandev along with other sages, they started going towards the sacrificial arena of Bali Maharaj. It is interesting to note that although Bali is a asura and Bali wants to do things on his own, he still agreed that we will do 100 sacrifices. That's the qualification test for being a Indra. 100 Ashwamedh Yajnas and you qualify. So he is called Shata Kratu. Shata 100, Kratu is Yajna. And Shakra for short. Like you have people, who was that fellow MGR? So something like that, NTR, MGR. So Shata Kratu is Shakra. That's Indra. Actually, things were quite nice when Bali Maharaj was ruling. Rain was proper, crops, fruits, vegetables, management. The only thing was he and his band of followers, they had kind of usurped the kingdom. Sometimes people say that, you know, even when the mafia rules, things are proper. Like in communist countries, they say there was no crime. Not that there was no crime, but mainly criminals were ruling. So why should there be crime on the streets? There was big time crime going on behind the scenes. So he had performed 99 such sacrifices. The last one was just about to begin. And that's where the arena is, set a fire sacrifice according to the Puranas was not something like we see in Kali Yuga, in one corner something is happening and swaha swaha. It is described that it could be like one village, thousands of Purohits, Ritviks, that's what they are called, the Ritvij, they are chanting the mantras. There are referee priests moving around, checking whether the pronunciation is correct or not. One ah, if it is too long, then it is not allowed. Or if it is aha, if it is too short, it is not allowed. So you have to chant properly. Hundreds and hundreds of ingredients, tons of ghee. So that was like a proper Vedic fire sacrifice. And suddenly they see this small boy. Vaman basically means a dwarf. This dwarf walking in, almost as if the sun has come in. Who is he? Bali Maharaj is about to sit on his proper asan. There is Diksha. What we know as Diksha is, that's one type of Diksha. But for every yagya, the host takes a Diksha. And then if it is a king, then he will not do any fighting, he will not do any other things. He will be just focused on the proper. So he has taken yagya Diksha. And then he sees this Brahmana boy coming. So this is 8:18:29, if you are interested in knowing which verse this is. Lord Vamandev has just entered the arena, and there he says, Shri Balir Uvacha, Swagatam te namastubhyam brahmanikam karavamate brahmarshinam tapasakshan manne tvaryavapurdharam. I offer you my hearty welcome and my respectful obeisances. Please let us know, what can I do for you? You are so effulgent. You look like Vapur Dharam, personified tapasya. One Vedic word for a Brahmana who does austerities is called Tapodhana. Some of you might have heard. Tapasya is his wealth. Tapodhana. So Bali Maharaj welcomes him and he says that you have arrived at my home, all my forefathers are satisfied, our family, our entire dynasty have been sanctified, and the sacrifice we are performing is now complete because of your presence. I see that you have come right at the beginning of the sacrifice. Is there something that I can give you? So normally, a Brahmana would depend upon society. He would not take any salary, he would not take any income for the benefit of society. So that's why I'm just giving this background as to why Bali Maharaj is offering him so many things. One of the last famous powerful Brahmanas was Chanakya, and there are some stories about him that a foreigner from China, maybe, he came and he asked people that, I would like to interview this advisor to the king, how do I meet him, where do I meet him? They said, oh, you won't, it's not a problem. There's a palace, and outside the palace there is a small hut where this Chanakya Pandit stays. He says, really? If he's the advisor, why doesn't he stay with the king? He says, no, he is independent. So this interviewer, this guest, he entered the hut. He found that with a lamp, he was doing some work. Then he put off that lamp and then lit a small candle. So he said, already it is not, the light was not sufficient for this room, and now you have lit even a smaller lamp. He said, this is what I get for my official work. This is for government work. Now we are talking personal things. This is what I get by begging. So he said, if the advisor works at this level of integrity, he says, my questions are answered. In fact, Chanakya Pandit was asked by the king. One day he said, Acharya, you said there are two options to this one particular situation, and let's say option A and B, and you are favoring B. I think A also is a better option. He said, the next time you speak about this, I am out of your service. When I give you something, I properly think on it. Now, just because he doesn't owe him 1 cent or a paisa, he can talk like that. So, practically we have lost that culture where people were so upright and so honest. So, it is not that because they don't have a job they are brahmanas. It is because they are brahmanas they should not be doing any jobs. The other way round. Lord Ramchandra came after winning Sita, defeating Ravana, and then his Rajyabhishek, his coronation was performed. At one point, he got the brahmanas there and said, I give you the eastern direction, I give you the western direction, I give you the southern direction, I give you the northern direction. Which means now I don't have anything. And what did the brahmanas do? They gave it back. So when I read for the first time, I was thinking, what's the point in getting something and again giving it back? Any idea what was the reason? Mahaprasad. Yes. The Kshatriyas should have the feeling that I am ruling on behalf of the real owners. The real owners are the Brahmanas and they have given it up. And for the Brahmanas, if they feel that this was mine, and if they have any attachment, that would immediately burn up their Brahma Tejas. So that factor always kept them. In fact, like let's say you go to a shop and it is said Black Friday or whatever, free offer, something, get any number of goods, gadgets or whatever, but it should all be within 4.5 kilos. 1 gram more than 4.5 and your head will be chopped off. Now you may take a laptop Air, but still it weighs 3.5 kilos. You want an adapter which is heavier than the laptop or so many other things. But will you actually wait till the whole thing goes up to 4.5? If it goes like in flights, 23 kilograms allowed, but you stop at 21.5. Who knows, that airport scale may have some own way of thinking. So we rather go for the lower mark rather than exactly 23 and argue with them, or in this case. So similarly, Brahmanas would be given charity, they would take all of that and they would reduce everything to less than minimum for the fear that I should not lose my Brahminical prowess. So this is how Vedic society would keep that check and balance. It's not like how people, like just 2 days ago, this Twitter chairman or whatever CEO came to India and he was saying, destroy Brahminical patriarchy or whatever. So this is the notion that this whole system has been made so that a few people can enjoy at the cost of others. But the Vedic reality is completely different. It is not like that. It's the Brahmanas who actually suffer the most. Why? Because they have the capacity. They can take the training. After that, the administrative class. After that, the productive class. After that, the service of the tertiary sector. Anyone who doesn't fit in any of that, he just is classified as somebody on the fringe. On everything is counted by what is their outlook towards self-realization. The class of society which have no ambition towards self-realization, they move farther away, away, away like that. So that's why Prabhupada could look at this, one look at the Manhattan skyline, and he said, "Why Krishna, why you brought me to this horrible place?" Now I should honestly confess, I went there, I didn't look at it as a horrible place. In fact, I was gawking at it. Oh, 68 stories, 84 stories, my God. So that is what, how you can understand, you know, Prabhupada calling his own Guru Maharaj a Vaikuntha man, and we know how Prabhupada behaved. So, these are some of the things which a Brahmana could need or may be attracted to. So here is Bali Maharaj giving a list. "O son of a Brahmana, it appears that you have come here to ask me for something. You may take from me a cow." Cow is the first thing which they would need. Daily milk is needed for fire sacrifice. Ghee is needed for fire sacrifice. "You want gold, a furnished house, palatable food and drink. Oh, perhaps you're not married yet. The daughter of a Brahmana for your wife. Maybe you want prosperous villages, horses, elephants, chariots, something. There should be something in your mind you are attracted to." So, I'll take a brief pause here. Bali is treating Vamandev just like any ordinary yachak, any ordinary beggar. And Bali has fulfilled the desires of thousands and thousands of such yachakas, such people. He knows it's his duty. In fact, what is a guest called? Atithi. Slightly inaccurate, a guest is called Abhyagat, because you know he's coming. Tithi means a date. Atithi, when you don't know somebody may come and he shows up at the door, that's a atithi. So when you ask, "Please come to my home for prasad," or "Please come for this," or "Please come for that," and then you serve that person, the devotee, Vaishnava, whatever, you get, say, this much punya. But if somebody comes uncalled for and still you serve nicely, it goes up, because you were not prepared. So, atithya satkar, atithi devo bhava. Not that he is God, but by serving him, it shows your culture and how you understand that by serving such a person who is uncalled for, uninvited, but he has come, it's my good fortune. So that's how a grihastha should see. So now, when the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vamandev, heard Bali Maharaj, he was very satisfied. And Bali Maharaj also was feeling very comfortable that this person is going to ask something. Vamandev says, "I know that until now, no one taking birth in your family has been poor-minded or miserly. No one has refused to give any charity. Nor after promising to give charity has anyone failed to fulfill the promise." Vamandev has started to place the setting properly. He said, no one has refused to give charity to Brahmanas, and nor after promising to give charity has anyone backtracked, anyone failed to give. So, Bali Maharaj is saying, oh yes, of course, of course. And now, there is a strange thing, 19th chapter, 3rd and 4th verse, Vamandev actually starts praising him. Now we are going upward. Bali, his father is Virochan. So Bali was sometimes addressed as Vairochana, the son of Virochan. The story doesn't come in Bhagavatam, it comes in some other Puranas. That demigods came disguised as Brahmanas and asked Virochan for his life. And he said yes. That was his charitable nature. So Bali Maharaj, you are belonging to such family, such illustrious people who are so charitable. And then Vamandev starts funnily speaking about, and the great Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha, they are also part of your family. Hiranyakashipu was so powerful that when he saw that his brother was killed by Vishnu, he swore that I will kill Vishnu. And Bali Maharaj is hearing all that. Now where to find Vishnu? Where does he stay? So they say he stays in Vaikuntha. Hiranyakashipu went there. Which is his palace? Now, I don't know how he found out the particular palace. But he went in that palace, saw the throne of Vishnu, and saw it was empty. He said, hey, what happened? Where did this person go? So Vishnu actually took shelter in Hiranyakashipu's heart. That's how it is described. Because introspection is the last thing a demon will ever do. They are described as Bahir Drishti, always looking for happiness outside, always looking for any kind of reasoning, any kind of logic, any kind of thing. The Drishti is always outside. And only when we come to spiritual life, we are told to look within, look within, look within. So, my dear Bali, in your dynasty, Hiranyakasipu was born. Hiranyakashipu was born. Seeing Hiranyakashipu coming forward, bearing a trident in his hand, Lord Vishnu, the knower of progress and time, thought as follows: it is better for me to enter into his heart. Because of his power to see only externally, he will not find me. So, Bali Maharaj was very happy, and Vamandev continued that you have observed the principles followed by your great, for the great personalities, by your forefathers, all are heroes. Now in 16th verse, Vamandev actually brings up the main issue. Tasmat tvatto mahimishad vrineham vardarshabhat padani trini daityendra sammitani padamama. Padani trini. O king of the daityas, from your majesty who come from such a noble family, who are able to give charity munificently, I ask only 3 paces of land. That's all. Oh, I know you are capable of giving much more, but I do not want anything that is unnecessary. And then he says, if a learned brahmana takes charity from others only according to his needs, it does not become entangled in sinful activities. So that's why this big thing about how much do we need? What's our actual need? A few weeks ago, I was reading a story by Leo Tolstoy. It described a small tribe living on the outskirts of the Russian Empire, and every month at a particular date they hold a ritual where somebody can go and talk to the chief and say, I want to buy some land. So the understanding is, from morning, daybreak, you go in any direction, and before dusk you come back, that much land is yours. So one nobleman thought, I want to do some farming, I want to build a house, so this could be a good proposition. So he went there, he said, what's the price? So it was some trinkets, some necklaces, some gold, little bit, very cheap from his point of view. And as soon as the day broke, he started walking. Russia, if some of you have known about the geography, is a vast land. It's called a steppe. So he saw one particular small forest area. He says, very good. Then he saw a small hill, so I like. Then a meadow, then a small lake. He kept on walking, and he was knowing that one point of time I should turn back. So then, remember the condition. You go from point A to this point, and then you come back before dusk. That much land is yours. As he kept on walking, he thought, this small piece looks very beautiful. I should hate not to go there. But hey, I have to come back also. So he again had to just fight his own desires. Just one last small forest of land that became too big. One small lake, one small river. Now it was past noon. And he was thinking, okay, now I have to go back. So, too much. I know, enough is enough. He started walking back. And he thought that after this hill, then I'll come to the chief's village and then I will settle the transaction. He said, my goodness, I know there are two more hills. Now he started running. It was 4 o'clock. He ran. It was not two more hills, it was three more hills. Now the sun was almost about to touch the horizon. He was running at the top of his speed. His lungs were about to burst. And then as he came down that hill, he found that the chief's village is still far away. Now the sun had almost set. In his heart, he was crying. He said, why I was so greedy? But then now, his energy was failing him. Finally, he made it to the chief's village. Practically at a breaking point, he saw the same villagers assembled. His heart gave away and he dropped down dead. And Leo Tolstoy says, how much land does a man actually need? He said, that one only needed 6 feet by 2 feet. That was enough for him to be buried. So this is a deep question. I had to spend so much time making up this background of the story. Now we are kind of approaching the tough philosophical tension between two powerful thoughts. So, if you have any questions, you are welcome. We'll have 5-10 minutes for any questions also. So, since Vamandev is showing such kind of a very conservative attitude, I say 3 paces means 3 paces, no more than that, don't worry. But Bali Maharaj is now kind of rebuking him. He is saying that, hey, you are giving me good instructions about how somebody should be satisfied and this and that. Nonetheless, you are a boy, Balish Mati. You're just a small boy. Your intelligence is insufficient. You're not very prudent in regard to your own self-interest. You know whom are you asking? I am Bali. I am able to offer you an entire island. Now here, island doesn't mean just a place surrounded by water. There are Swapta Dvipas in the whole planet. I can give you anything. I am the proprietor of the 3 divisions of the universe. You have come to ask something, you have to come to take something from me. You have pleased me by your sweet words, but you are not very intelligent. Let me first of all instruct you as to how much you can get from me. So, O small boy, one who approaches me to beg something should not have asked anything more. I don't want that you get something from me today and tomorrow again you have to beg. Let it be that I am the one who has given you something. See, the whole idea was And later you should tell everybody that this is given by Bali, this was given by Bali, this was given by Bali. So that's the kind of a mood of a donor. Text 21 is a classic text worthy of spending some time on it. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Yavanto Vishaya Preshthas Trilokya Majitendriyam Nashaknuvantite Sarve Pratipurya Pratipurayitum Nripa. The Lord said, my dear King, even the entirety of whatever there may be within the three worlds to satisfy one's senses cannot satisfy a person whose senses are uncontrolled. That time Barimar was thinking, hey, this fellow came as a beggar and is giving me big time instructions. That thing came up. But just see what Vamandev is saying. The whole focus from 8.19.21 is on something called contentment. There are people who don't have, economists call them have-nots. And there are people who have, they are called the haves. Haves and haves not, have nots. But one thing is common in this Kali Yuga, both are not satisfied. So where do you get satisfaction? Where do you get contentment? In our MBA class, I remember 1987-88, there is the first person who got a PhD in management. He wrote his thesis. I think I had requested you to find it in Kalina. Remember, Pashavan Prabhu? They don't have a copy there, by the way. They say we lost it. The first ever management PhD thesis, P.N. Singh, I remember his name. Maybe he's still maybe managing something somewhere. I said, sir, in corporate life, can we be satisfied? So he looked at me as if, you know, I had, like in a Bhagavad class, I started some Mayavad theory or something. He said, satisfaction is the end of life. I remember. And that day I knew I am not fit here in this environment. I don't know what I will do, where next, but I had a simple question. I was a little bit philosophical, a little bit poetical, but I said, what's wrong with satisfaction? And then, over the years, I could understand the space from where he was coming. He said, we only have two things, ambition and satisfaction. Both are opposites of each other. If you feel satisfied, you will not have ambition. If you have ambition, you can never be satisfied. So, they call it the dog-eat-dog world, they call it the rat race. And they themselves have so many theories about, even if you win the rat race, you remain a rat. So what's the point? I always loved economics. I used to read a lot. 2 days ago, there was one big paper about the pointlessness of working. Imagine, these scholars are saying, the one guy, big guy, Adam Smith, I don't know why his name should come up in a Bhagavad class, but in the beginning of the 20th century, he promised everybody, soon we will have 15-hour weeks. You have to work only for 15 hours. You may say, 15 hours a week? I work 15 hours a day. And I'm still not happy. So, they say hard work never killed anybody. But again they say, why take a chance? So basically we don't like to work. Srila Prabhupada, while teaching his Western audience, would say that. He says, basically we don't like to work. We are meant for enjoyment. But where is that enjoyment to be found? So, we do work, and then we glorify it, but we don't have that inner satisfaction. So satisfaction comes only when there is a spiritual culture. Again, a small example of an American lawyer who went for a holiday to Mexico's beaches, and there he said he found one fellow strumming his guitar. He said, "You are the reason why your country is so backward." He says, "What do you mean?" He said, "Look at me. I'm a lawyer. I'm from Manhattan. I work 12, 14 hours a day." He says, "What for?" "I have to save money." "What for?" "So I don't have to work afterwards." "Then what will you do?" "I will have my flat in Manhattan and I'll buy a beach house." "But what for?" "Well, after I retire, I'll just go there and play guitar all day." So he says, "But what? That's what I'm doing now." Without going through this whole thing. Now again, hard work is not denied, hard work is not discouraged, but the pointlessness is what people don't understand. And that point is something which Vamandev is trying to bring out from his conversation. So he's saying that if somebody is uncontrolled, nothing can satisfy him. Vamandev is now turning the whole argument on its head. "I were not satisfied with 3 pieces of land, as you are saying, you are a great king, you are offering me so much. I would not be satisfied even with possessing one of the 7 islands. If I possessed 1 island, I would hope for another one. If I have 2, I will desire 3. If I have 3, I will require 4. If I have all 9, I'll require something else somewhere." It seems like Alexander the Great was disappointed. There is nothing left to conquer. He complained, "There is nothing left now. I have conquered almost the world." But historians disagree. They say while he was conquering that area, this was conquered 2 years ago, already was lost. So he kept on conquering new things and kept on losing the old things. In fact, Prabhupada cautioned his followers, "Don't make me like Alexander. Like, you have all the temples which I made going down and you are opening new ones." He says, "Don't make me like Alexander." So, in verses 22 to 25 of chapter 21, we understand how, chapter 19, Vamandev explains, "Pumsoyam samsriter hetur asantosho arthakamayo yadichayopapannena santosho muktaye smrita." I said we will be discussing this thing of santosh or satisfaction. Material existence causes discontent in regard to fulfilling one's lusty desires, achieving more and more money. This is the cause for the continuation of material life, which is full of repeated birth and death. But for one who is satisfied by that which is obtained by destiny, is fit for liberation from this material existence. Vamandev cautions him, if a Brahmana, now again, this is not meant for the entire society, he is talking from his point of view. I have come as a Brahmana. A Brahmana who is satisfied with whatever is providentially obtained, his power increases. But the spiritual potency of a dissatisfied Brahmana decreases as fire diminishes in potency when water is sprinkled upon it. I may lose all my spiritual power just by being greedy. Therefore, he is again praising Bali. "You are Varadarshabhat, the best of those who can give charity. I just want 3 paces of land. That's all. Tasmat trini padanyeva vrine tvad varadarshaba." I stick to my original statement. 3 paces means 3 paces only. Now, Bali, what can he do? He just laughs. Hasan aha. He says, "Okay, all right. I'm not here to improve your IQ. I know that you, I tried to teach you so many things about how great I am, I can do so much. All right. Whatever you like. And as per Vedic culture, when you are supposed to give something, you reach for your water pot. That's like your checkbook. Yeah, water pot means you take water, put it on your right hand, palm, and you release that water saying, Tathastu, Tathastu, whatever you say, may it be so. So if you say, I want 3 pieces of land, yes, this is hereby I am giving you. So Vamandev was happy that at least now he has agreed. Meanwhile, Shukracharya, he is looking at Bali speaking so many ways, looking at Vamandev speaking so many things. It looks like Srila Prabhupada describes Shukracharya as a materialistic person. But that's like how Arjuna is described as someone who came into illusion. I was just discussing with some devotees on the way. Read the Bhagavad Gita purports for the first chapter. One verse, Prabhupada says, Arjuna doesn't want to fight because he has compassion. He's a Vaishnava. Of course, he's a pure devotee. How can you expect him to just kill at random? And soon in the next purport, Prabhupada says, he doesn't want to fight. That's weakness of the heart. You may say suddenly he's hero in one purport and zero in another purport. You need to understand the Vedic language, you need to understand Prabhupada's purports, you need to understand these events. It takes some time, at least I realize that. Because Bhurijan Prabhu said it took him 28 years to understand Bhagavad Gita, and that's how we get this surrender unto me, a succinct understanding of the whole Gita text. So why Shukracharya is suddenly now behaving like a villain? He's not a villain exactly. Let us see what Shukdeva Goswami says. Vishnave kshmam pradasyatam pradasyantam ushana asureshwaram janam chikirshitam vishno shishyam praha vidam varaha. Vishnave kshmam pradasyantam. One look at Vamandev and he knew he is Vishnu. Bali, you are giving something to Vishnu. Do you know what is going to happen? How do we know, the audience who are reading Srimad Bhagavatam, as to what exactly is in Shukracharya's mind? Shukdeva Goswami very intelligently calls him Vidam Varaha, the best of the knowers of everything. So it's not that he came under some kind of illusion or whatever. Shukracharya basically is playing his role in this divine leela. Esha vairochane sakshat bhagavan vishnur avyayah kashyapad aditer jato devanam karya sadaka. This is a vairochane. Why should he address him as vairochane? Your father also did some this kind of mistake. Just agreed to give any kind of charity. Don't commit the same mistake again. This is Bhagwan, Vishnu, Avyaya. Kashyapad aditer jato. Just to put that little bit of extra chili and pepper into his mind. Aditi, Aditi's sons. Your mother is Diti. There has to be some kind of rivalry. Sapatnya. Co-wife rivalry. Basically, the word for a competitor and a co-wife are the same. Sapatni. Arjuna also says, Rajyam suranam api chadipatyam. Sapatnam, asapatnam. There are no enemies, there are no competitors. So co-wives are generally seen as enemies. Remember Prabhupada's story? A man had an old wife, olden times, and then he married another young one. And he would divide time, I don't know how, but accordingly. So the young wife would pluck out his white hairs just so that she should look okay with him. And when he would come to the old wife, she would pluck out his black hairs. Because she also was graying and then she wanted him to be compatible. In the end, he lost both. So, Vamandev is born of Aditi. And please understand, Devanam Karya Sadhakaha. He has come with a motive to do the purpose of the Devas who are your enemies. Why don't you understand? You do not know what a dangerous position you have accepted by promising to give him land. I frankly think this is not good for you. It will bring great harm to the demons. But the demons are also listening. They're thinking that Bali is our leader, our boss. And boss means who works for our welfare. He thinks of us all the time. So Shukracharya is trying to heat up the situation as much as possible. He goes on, this person falsely appearing as a brahmachari is actually the supreme personality of Godhead, Hari, who has come in this form. You know what he will do? He will take away your land, your wealth, your beauty, power, fame, education, and he will give it to Indra. That's actually worse than simply taking it away. Taking away is one thing, but giving it to Indra? You promise to give him 3 steps of land. You know what will happen? He will occupy the 3 worlds. You are a rascal. You do not know what a great mistake you have made. After giving everything to Vishnu, you will have no means of livelihood. How shall you live? Radha Govind Maharaj says, taking the mentality of a professional brahmana, here the wording is not, how shall you live? How shall I live after that? Isn't it? So basically, like sometimes, if the father goes away or the mother goes away, the children say, what will happen to us now? So the problem is not that you have gone. The problem is, now we have to fend for ourselves. Shukracharya, Vadamvira, the one who, Vidamvara, the best of knowers, Vamandev will first occupy the 3 worlds with 1 step. Then he will take his 2nd step, that will be outer space. Then he will expand his universal body to occupy everything. Where will you give him the space to put his 3rd step? It's almost, this lila has not happened yet. And Shukracharya is just telling, this is exactly what will happen. You are saying, I will give you. You will be unable to fulfill your promise. And I think because of this, you will reside in hell. Now, from text 36, the tension which I promised, this is beginning now. From 36 to about 10 more verses, 8 more verses. Shukra Niti comes in for discussion. So little bit about that first. Oh no, what I will do is I will tell the whole scheme now. We have about 20 more minutes. So that's appropriate. How does one live in this world? There are do's and there are don'ts. We have become devotees, at least we have taken the 1st step. Should we follow worldly wisdom or should we follow transcendental life in all aspects of our lives? Seems like common sense is we should do that introspection, understand where we stand, and then take steps accordingly. Especially with regards especially with regards to relinquishing material possessions. So whatever study I did of these particular verses as to why Shukracharya is telling don't give, don't give, don't give. First of all, Shukracharya is considered one of Krishna's vibhutis, Ushana Kavi. Here he is called the best of the knowers. And Vedic culture just doesn't tell you you're not the body, you're spirit, soul, forget it, go back home, back to God. No, there is a process for it. And one aspect of that is, how do we live in this world? And that is called Niti. There is Vidur Niti, Brihaspati's Niti, there is Aesop Niti outside India also, Aesop's fables. But Shukracharya's Niti is the one which is recommended by Krishna many, many times. Why is that? So, the first 15 minutes that I am speaking, I'll speak as if this is the Niti to be followed by everybody. After that, I'm again revealing the crux of the thing. Bali Maharaj defeats his Guru Maharaj's ideas. Strange. The whole understanding of today's thing is defiance. A Shishya is disobeying his Guru. Why? Only one reason. Because he's giving charity to Vishnu himself. Radha Govind Maharaj says very clearly, if Vishnu was not in the picture, then Shukracharya's arguments are rock solid. Let us begin with that. Na taddanam prashamsamti yena vrittir vipadyate danam yagyas tapak karma loke vritti mato yataha. He says that don't give out of sentiment. People give something out of sentiment and then later file lawsuit against those who have given something. I want it back. Does it happen? Very frequently. In fact, those of you who are old timers here, I stayed in that Ramjiwai Satsang. Somebody gave a whole building to Radhanath Maharaj saying that Radharani, was it something like that? Radharani told him to give and she's the one who told him to take it back? That we don't know. But the reason was that it's very difficult. So Shukracharya is protecting those who hear his views of either premature renunciation or prematurely giving up everything. What he's saying here is, na tad danam prashamsanti. Learned scholars do not praise that charity which endangers one's own livelihood. Charity, sacrifice, austerity and fruitive activities are possible for one who is competent to earn his livelihood properly. He said, you want to give everything today to only one Brahmana? What about tomorrow? Tomorrow if somebody comes, what will you say? Finished. Close shop. I gave everything yesterday. Don't come now. Think about the future. You as a Grihastha, you should be giving charity regularly every day if it matters. So don't think like that. Shukracharya gives another formula. Divide your wealth into five parts. Now it's not like 20%, but five. Dharmaya, yashase, arthaya, kamaya, svajanaya cha, panchadha vibhajan vittam, iham utra cha modate. He says you can be happy if you divide your resources five parts. Which are the five? Dharma, for religion. Religion means some religious activity, supporting some spiritual institution, doing your pujas at home if they have an altar. Yashase, Shukracharya is saying, it is good for a grihastha to have this reputation, oh, this person is a very charitable person. It's good. It is part of your grihastha dharma. Arthaya, to increase your opulence. Money attracts money. Prabhupada should say, one person said, are you intelligent? He said, what are you checking at your pockets? He said, well, if I have money, I am intelligent. So from a very, very simple angle, a grihastha should actively keep money so as to invest that, and that can give him more, and that can make him perform more charitable work. Kamaya, for sense gratification. Not everybody in this world is fit for just living in the ashram or for relinquishing everything. The Upadesh is there. But actually, Shukracharya is telling that keep something, like in the Ishopanishad, Prabhupada says, how much sense gratification? As much as salt is necessary in food. If there is too much salt, everybody says salt, 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 too much salt. Too less salt, again salt, 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 we need salt. Right salt, nobody talks of salt. They talk about other things. The rasgulla is nice, pakoda is nice, sabji is nice. But salt comes in the picture only if it is too less or too more. So sense gratification should be that kind of a required thing in everybody's life. Swajanayacha. And for your own family members, Swajan here means immediate family, a bit extended family. Panchadhar, so I'll repeat again, for dharma, for yasha, for artha, for kama, and for swajana. If you don't do that, you won't be happy in this material world. Bali Maharaj may look at him and say, what are you saying? As if, does it have any Vedic support, if there is any? He says, okay, I will now give you something straight from the Rig Veda. So, text 38, 39 and 40, up to 41 also, these are texts taken straight from the Rig Veda. He says, look, I'll teach you something. Om. Om basically means, we think it is Krishna address, the impersonal form of Krishna. Om also means yes. So, have you actually said Om to what this Brahmana has said? I want 3 pieces of land. You haven't said Om yet, right? Ha! So, just say no. Like somebody says, you know, we have some charity program. Can you give you 5,000? Said no. That's good. That will protect. If everybody who comes and asks for charity and you say yes, very soon you won't have anything. Again, please keep yourself. Later we will overturn this kind of thinking. But this is Shukra Niti. He's saying, say no immediately, so that you are protected. And then if you want to give, you can give something little, no problem with that. Om means yes, dangerous position. No means I don't have any. Like sometimes, of course, later he says, don't overdo it. We will come to that later. So 38 to 43 is a little bit tough section because it contains directly portions from the Rig Veda. What basically I understood from that is, this body is untruth. Fact. It is there today, gone tomorrow. So this untruth body has to live on untruth only. You have to say sometimes, like if any of you grihasthas working, the government says, how much money you have? You may say, hey, don't disclose. They'll take away everything. Now this is happening during those days where kings were good. What about now? I remember there was an MBA class, and some of my friends, they asked Sinaji Prabhu that, so you are such a big businessman and you give business wisdom. Do you follow all the laws? And I know my friend, he embarrassed by saying, do you follow income tax laws? And I was thinking, my God, did I make a mistake in calling these fellows here? So Sinaji Prabhu, a pro at answering these questions, he says, I have been taught by my spiritual master not to break laws, but I try to bend them in my favor. So that's what I do practically. He began by saying that for a businessman to survive today is difficult, which is a fact. When I am following four equity principles, I am trying to live a proper version of life, and there is a government which is not following that. There are government servants who are not following that. So my money, if it goes for their sinful activities, I am also implicated. So he said something like, a specific percentage which the Vedas say give to the government, I give. He says the rest of that is all tax planning. Makes sense. So if untruth is uprooted, the body becomes dry. So it is always safe to say no. But don't overdo it. Because somebody who keeps hoarding money and just not spending it for anything, he says that person is dead. Even though living, is dead. The other day, Deen Gaurang Prabhu told a story about a man, successful businessman in interior Maharashtra. So land, trees, agriculture, he was having some shops. Somehow he lost his ability to speak. The last 15 days or so, suddenly he would get some urge, he would say something unintelligible. But the last 2 days, those who were his caretakers could understand he's saying limbu, lemon. So they said maybe he wants limbu pani, lemon juice, or he wants a piece of lemon. So when they would bring him, he would make as if he doesn't want that. He was desperate to tell them, but this was the end time, there was nothing he could do. And he passed away. So they were saying, you remember he was talking about lime, lemon, lemon, lemon. Then the sons agreed to divide the property. There was something which was a like arid kind of land. They decided to sell it. There were a few trees in it. They sold it. There was a lemon tree there. The new developers started digging. And they found a big box containing golden ornaments under that lemon tree. So what this gentleman was trying to tell them, that many years ago, just to keep it very safe, there was a lot of gold kept under that lemon tree. But because of his inability, he could only speak lemon, lemon, lemon. The world around could not understand what that meant. So this is what Shukracharya is saying. Don't overdo this thing of saying no, no, no to everything. Then even while living, you are like just a dead person. Now this is something which I found it interesting, that Shukracharya is saying, where can you speak a lie? Bhagavatam teaches you how to do that for all things. Strishu narma vivahe cha vrityarthe prana sankate go brahmanarthe hinsayam nanritam swajjuk syat jugupsitam. With your wife you can tell a lie. I'm not looking at that section, I'm looking at... You may say, really? Why didn't you meet me before? No, but don't take it as a license. It simply means, to those wives who simply keep on bugging their husband that, you know, get this, get this, get this, get this. So you never say, watch my lips, I don't have it, I'm not going to buy it. That's a disaster, don't do that. Just say, just now coming, yes, yes, surely, why not? Next bonus, next Diwali, next New Year, whatever. Narma means in joking, joking means exaggeration, not a lie, but exaggeration. Vivahe, the great Indian tradition of exaggerating somebody's exploits. Oh, you know, how is this girl? Oh, as they say in Maharashtra, lakhat ek. She's like, lakho me ek. And afterwards, sometimes you find that, oh, he is not from IIT, he is from ITI. So, little bit of a change of syllable words here and there. But actually, Shukracharya says, vrityarthe, in business. I mean, how can you do business without lying? Prabhupada writes in a Bhagavad Gita purport that, I'm selling it to you, sir, I'm not making any profit on this. He says, actually, at least making 50% profit. But unless he says that, how is he going to sweeten the whole transaction? So, vrityarthe, go brahmana arthe. Brahmanas are not supposed to speak lies, but to save them for their welfare. It is said, this is a slightly serious matter, ethics. A person has taken a vow, I will be satyavadi, I will only speak the truth. And he's doing his meditation or some jap or something. And then he sees a cow running like mad, going in this direction. And soon, people armed with sticks, axes, and they are coming behind. He said, did you see a cow going this any way? He just does like that. Said, I'll not speak anything. It is described that, this is a Vedic example, he was implicated in Gohatya. Your vow is for your benefit, your edification, your education, your culture. But if your small vow succeeds in breaking a bigger principle, it is useless. Hinsayam, if an enemy has caught somebody and is about to kill him, you can take shelter of untruth. Na andritam syaj jugupsitam. Shukracharya says, in those cases, certainly, this is not bad. So a brief recap. Shukraniti to be followed, especially in worldly life, because this world out there is like that. And even between devotees, we are all struggling. We may like to call ourselves neophytes, we like to call ourselves Madhyamadhikaris. Simple thing, how Prabhupada was so clear and how Prabhupada was so astute in his observation. I remember many years ago, slightly disconnected thing, but see if you can see the connection. Whether we should have real gold, silver, diamond ornaments for the deities. Because somebody had come and they said, we will give you honor. We would like to give. And then we started trying to understand what Prabhupada has said about it. To our surprise, we got a letter, Prabhupada is telling, please do not put real gold things in our temples. Two reasons he gives. One is, we may attract thieves. And second, he says, even our people are not prepared and trained yet. Which is a fact. So if your deity worship, if your archana goes on nicely with some compromise, better to do that. Main purpose is to chant Hare Krishna, preach about Krishna Katha, distribute Krishna Prasad, and that's how the training process will work. So please, I'll repeat once again, this kind of thing is meant for worldly-minded people, grihasthas, budding transcendentalists, neophytes. Shukra Niti has to be observed as per the recommendation of Krishna himself. There's only one small hitch in this Leela. The recipient of charity is Vishnu himself. So now, we are going to reverse everything what we kind of learned. Only for this particular case, I'll repeat once again. Bali Maharaj said, okay, you are saying that, first of all, he remained silent for a moment. He said, this is Vishnu here. My guru is saying, he will take away everything. So he starts giving very solid reasons. This is Maharaj, Acharya. What you say is true. I agree. See the difference. Shukracharya is calling him a disciple. You need to be taught, you need to be trained, you need to be educated. And Bali Maharaj is saying, he didn't say directly, I'm not your disciple anymore. I am Prahladi. I am the grandson of Prahlad. That's my identity. Why should I say no? I will give. My whole lineage, especially Prahlad Maharaj, is a Vaishnav. I'm following him. Why not please this Brahmana? You are saying I have resources. They are always, the word, Sanskrit word is Kshana Bhangur. You might have read it. Which means, which can be lost in a moment. Kshana, moment, Bhangur, destroyed, disintegrated rather. So why be attached to assets, wealth, which necessarily will be lost at the time of my death? Dadhichi, Shibi, these are the great kings. Dadhichi gave his life so that his, from his bones a weapon can be made to attack the Asuras. Shibi, another famous king, a pigeon came saying, oh Maharaj, please save me. He said, okay, save, no problem, don't worry. Then a falcon came, or a hawk, and he said, Maharaj, I'm taking your shelter, I'm hungry. He says, whatever you want. He says, I want that pigeon. But I've already given him shelter. No, but that is my food. He said, I'm telling you, I've given him shelter, I'll offer anything in return. I want flesh, I'll give. Your own. He said, all right. So he was cutting his flesh, putting in a scale, and somehow the pigeon was still heavy. I don't think any chief executive will do that today. Finally, he sat down himself. At that time, they revealed themselves to be Agni and Indra. That's some stories go like that. He says, Maharaj, we're just testing you. So through the annals of history, Shibi is famous for giving that kind of charity. So I want good reputation. He says, people give money, people give charity of land, other things. I want to give charity to someone like him, a Brahmana or a saint, and Bali Maharaj gives a specific qualification, one who creates holy places wherever he goes. I remembered when Bhakti Vinod Thakur began his quest for asking donations for developing the Yoga Peeth. Amrit Bazaar Patrika, still there, there was a famous newspaper. So Tarun Kanti Ghosh, if I remember the name correctly, was the editor. So he wrote a column saying that to every Hindu household, if you are benedicted by the presence of Kedarnath Dutt at your doorstep, please do something for your eternal benefit by giving him a rupee, because that's what he will take. Once Bhaktivinoda Thakur asked him, do you know the six Goswamis? He says, I know the seventh. And that's how Bhaktivinoda Thakur became known as the seventh Goswami. At least he was perceptive. I mean, he could see that quality in him. So he says, I will please him by giving him something which is already destined to die. There are great kings who do that. I will keep my reputation. I don't get a chance to serve Brahmanas who create holy places. I must give, I must give. He says, if he is Vishnu, he will take anyway. You are saying he is Vishnu, he is Hari, he will take anyway. So why I should fight him? If he is not, then he will be facing my arrows in battle. So Bali Maharaj is very clear. If, as you are saying, he is Vishnu, I will be giving him for sure. Shukracharya has heard enough. He says, I am cursing you, you will be bereft of all your opulences. He said as if, what's the new thing in it? I am already going to be bereft. But because of the Guru's curse, Bali Maharaj, I mean, when the Guru cursed him, he just accepted it. He called his wife, Vindhyavali. She brought a golden water pot. He poured that water. He says, I hereby give you whatever you want. And I will round up the whole story. It's a bit detailed, but that's not our focus was on. These instructions, Shukra Niti, vis-a-vis what Bali Maharaj said, that why did he defy? Why did he disobey? Because he could achieve Krishna, Krishna Prapti. That was the main thing. Suddenly, please understand, it's not like Vamandev's body grew and then they all came in it. His body grew and then they found themselves, we are already in him. One foot, lotus foot went down, so the middle and lower planets were covered. The body kept on growing. The lotus foot went up, up, up till Siddhalok, Charanalok, Jannalok, Tapalok, Maharlok, Brahmalok, and there all the Rishi Munis, they could see the supremely effulgent lotus foot coming. It went and it pierced the covering of the universe. And water started trickling down. That's what Ganga. So that from that hole, it came down. And then Vamandev looked at Bali and said, only two paces I have taken. Where is the space for the third one? So after some deliberation, there is another philosophical deliberation, he said, this is symbolic of my ego. So he put his foot down on his head and the demon associates were saying, hey, this fellow comes in like a beggar and now he's made our boss into a beggar. So they bring up their weapons. Vishnu's associates start fighting them. Bali Maharaj says, hey, stop. Nobody should fight him. To add insult to injury, Lord Vishnu orders Garuda, bind him. This fellow is a criminal. He said three paces, he couldn't fulfill his promise. So they bind him with Varuna Pash. At that time, Vindhyavali, his wife, comes in. My Lord, such a lashing she gives her husband. She said, my Lord, he's talking to Vamandev, there are some who think themselves to be the Lord of the universe, Lord of the planets. It's good that you have reduced their pride. It's good you have crushed their ego. And Bali had to listen to this whole thing. Imagine, from your own wife, in front of the Lord. But he was not saying anything. Then Prahlad came. That time Prahlad Maharaj was an old person. Vayovriddha, Prashanta, he was sober. Therefore he was still staying with the family. Indra was given his kingdom. Indra was very happy. Indra is like a businessman, I just get what I want. And the demigods got their respective places, they went to their palaces. I'll end with this small thing. I used to always think, Krishna fulfills all your desires to the max. That's what somebody promised me when I joined the Hare Krishna movement. That he will fulfill your desires to the maximum. And that time I wanted a Bhagavad Gita. Macmillan, big size, not available anywhere. And I went before Radha Gopinath and said, let me test him. I have just joined this temple, whether the process really works or not. So I said, my Lord, if possible, I would like to have a Bhagavad Gita. After some time, a boy came and joined the temple. At that time, you could join and go off as per your sweet will. So for 3 days he was in the ashram, and then he left. Rasamrita Maharaj was our president. So he said, you clean up his locker. That's your service for today. So I opened his locker. It was already clean. There was nothing in it, except one plastic bag. I opened it. There was a Macmillan Bhagavad Gita. So later I came to know that one philosopher said, beware, your prayers could be answered. So that time I could understand that before praying for something, let us pray for intelligence as to what to pray for. That's a much safer position than getting something from Krishna. Like somebody, a simple person, wants a Mercedes car and he gets it, and afterwards somebody bangs it. The bumper is dented or whatever, and you go to the repair shop and they say, this is a Mercedes shop, so only exclusively we cater to these. So normally paint job is 15,000, but Mercedes means 45,000. So you may say, I don't want it now. Everything is very expensive. That's a fact. So before you ask for something, at least ask, Lord, first give me the intelligence whether I deserve it or not, whether I can handle it or not. So the demigods get what they want. Bali wanted a kingdom. Bali wanted to become Indra. 99 yagyas were done for that. What did he get actually? Insult, injury, loss of reputation, infamy, being bound like a criminal. That's not how Krishna does things. As Krishna pushed him down, he said, I will give you a planet which technically is below, but is better than the heavenly planets. If anybody attacks you, my Sudarshan Chakra will be there to defend you. And I, Vamandev, will be your security guard posted outside. I read this many years ago. I said, still, he is the boss of Sutala, he is enjoying with Prahlad, his family. What about Indrapad? The real thing was to rule as an Indra. Vamandev said, in the next Manvantar, I'll make you Indra also. So, without a doubt, Krishna not only fulfills everything, but also gives you something more. In such a way he gives something more that I don't remember which book I read it, but Prabhupada said, even those who ask for impersonal liberation, my Lord, make me one with you, one with you, the begging process continues till the last point of liberation. Only when you become a Vaishnav Bhakta, the begging process stops. And Krishna can make you not just one, but even more than him. Prabhupada said, this is our Vaishnava process. So, thank you for being such a kind and patient audience. I'll stop here. Srila Prabhupada ki, Shri Shri Radha Gopinath ki, Dai Gaur Premanande.
RG Media YouTube channel. Like, share, subscribe.